Welcome back to Speak. This podcast aims to address the needs of our communities by breaking down social barriers through education, activism, and advocacy. We hope that this discussion inspires you to continue these conversations both in the space and beyond. I'm Tahreem.
I'm Monique.
I'm Mara.
And I'm Etsy. Change is an act, a resource, and a guide to bettering not only our own lives, but those of our community as well. Today's topic is the damsel in distress, feminism in the media, where we will be breaking down the ways that girls and women are portrayed in the media. We'll be discussing its influences and effects as we grow up, and we'll also be highlighting some of our favorite positive media that is breaking those barriers today.
Growing up, the media is a significant part of our core development and exposure to the world. It teaches us how we're supposed to look, act, and communicate, and it really has a hand in shaping many aspects of our thoughts, opinions, and personalities. Our generation in particular has been completely immersed in the media in some way, whether that's through traditional mediums like books and literature or contemporary outlets like TV, music, and social media. Either way, our exposure to certain types of media speaks to the way we perceive ourselves and others as we mature.
Now, one of the most popular age trends in the media is the damsel in distress trope. In short, this archetype is a reoccurring narrative device in which a woman who is in some kind of danger is rescued by a male hero. This teaches girls that they are weak, violable, easily disposable, and incapable of being viewed as autonomous beings with their own independent wills. This ideal is something that is ingrained in us right from the very beginning, and we're taking a deep dive into what this looks like in our own lives today.
The media has great power. It teaches us what is and what isn't acceptable. It ultimately shapes our outlook on life. When we look at how women are generally portrayed in the media, we can observe certain trends are largely negative and extremely damaging. And so this brings me to think about how women are portrayed in the media. I know that we see a lot of objectification in various forms, and it's very, very hard to escape.
I remember, I think it was SD, we were talking about, I told you about this one ad about how it was a car ad, but it was basically they put a picture of a woman, and it's like, it doesn't matter if it's been used, it's pretty.
Yeah.
Are you serious?
BMW did this ad. You know you're not the first, and then this picture of the girl, apparently, like, saying, like, you're not the first person that used the car, her, but it's still embarrassing.
Yeah, like, I know. They wake up in the morning and said, this is what I want to put out today.
They're like,
you know, you're not the first.
Who looks at these and is like, I think it's totally okay. Let's put it out. I want this on the front page tomorrow. Like, what?
It so definitely will be on the front page, but for the wrong reasons, as it should be.
The car commercial thought they really did something with that. They thought they ate.
Give me back the plate. No, but and it also goes back to, like, we see those examples in modern media, but then we also have those examples in, like, children's media and things when we're growing up. So this whole damsel in distress trope, where do we see that the most? Fairy tales, right? So it's like,
that's
Cinderella
true.
Is
that's true.
What is it?
That's the starting point, really.
Or, like, the girl in the tower. Rapunzel.
don't do my girl Rapunzel like that girl in the tower. Excuse me.
But, you know, like, she needed to be saved. Like, Sleeping Beauty, like, the prince had to, you know. All these examples are making women, like, a prize of sorts, because there's a common thread. At the end, the woman gets saved, and then she becomes, like, a prize. They get married, live happily ever after, but that's not necessarily always the case. And that kind of teaches us to rely on men for everything, you know?
Yeah,
and you know what? That's a really good way of starting it off, like, in conversation, because that is, like I said, it's a starting point. And it's really interesting that you brought up Rapunzel, because even, like, the newer Rapunzel movie, Tangled, which I actually love so much, but, like, I can't help but think that, oh, even when they tried to, like, be, like, give it an upgrade almost, it's still kind of giving that same thing, despite the criticism, because we know there is lots of it. They just get away with it time and time again. And so also in Tangled, and really in any fairy tale, and this is not limited to fairy tales, literally everywhere in the media, there are always these certain personality traits that make women very one-dimensional, to say the least. Like, there's always this whole thing about going on whether, not whether, that they are. There's this whole thing going on that they are weak, they're unopinionated, uneducated, and it just goes on and on. The list is never ending, and the disappointment along with it is also never ending.
Mm-hmm. There's always some sort of male character who's like either like plays a role in making her find her worth, or like, you know, making her see the beauty that she has or whatever, and I'm like, no. No,
because I actually might like puke in my mouth a little bit right now. That is disgusting.
Yeah, but I guess like we were just talking about how there's a lot of negative criticism, and I think a lot of I should say more of shows and movies, and there has been more positive media representation of women slowly, but it needs a lot more work.
Yeah, definitely. I would say that it is getting better, but the same notion that women need help by men, or they're over-sexualized, or they're weak, it's still there. So
it doesn't die, does it?
Like we all mentioned, like the car ad was a white woman, Rapunzel, white woman, Tangled, white woman, Snow White. Like, we can keep
Rapunzel
going on and on.
Tangled are the same.
Oh my god. But anyways, you know what I mean? Like, there's two different like movies, yeah, though, that came out, right? Yeah. There's still like a lack of representation from other races and ethnicities that I'm like, I don't know, is it just important for the white woman to be represented and to have this sort of dilemma of poor self-worth? Like, everyone goes through that, it's not just women. But for some reason they keep emphasizing that women go through that only.
Like, you're not being treated amazing here, but at least you're here. The rest,
yeah,
oh well.
Mm-hmm.
It really is that. And it seems like I said, it doesn't die. It's like every single time they're like, we've improved it, but it's still there. It's still, mm-hmm, there. It's almost like it's like an illusion almost, or they think they're tricking us, and sometimes they do, even if it's, mm-hmm, for a little bit. And yeah, it's very sickening. Women can only ever be one thing. It falls flat, and unfortunately it sells.
So now that we've identified the harmful trends in media, now we will explore how the media affects our self-concept and our perceptions of other people as well. Now, this leads us to the following question. How does the media affect how we perceive ourselves? As we will be discussing this concept, we want you, the listener, to reflect on how the media affects you personally. So now we can see that the media can lead to having negative self-confidence. And unfortunately, this is seen in today's world as we're online all the time. And when you're online, you may be comparing yourself to other people, which may lead to poor self-worth and image, as well as body image issues and feeling the need to attain impossible beauty standards. What do you guys have to say on that?
I think because of how saturated this idea of, like, there's a lot of movies, I think we can all agree, where the main character, who is a female, has the unrealistic, like, body type, I guess you could say, that majority can only be achieved with some sort of, you know, alterations. So like, you know, like, it really does affect a lot of people. And I'm not saying that that body type isn't achievable, or like we shouldn't have that body type. I understand that some people have that naturally, but majority don't
hold everyone to that standard.
Exactly.
And the issue is that that's all that we see too.
Exactly. Right?
Another thing that bothers me, you know, like, there's always like the nerdy girl, and she has curly hair and she wears glasses, and then she has a makeover and all she does is straighten her hair.
Oh my god, are you talking about?
Who is that? You know that movie, is it like The Princess Diaries?
Princess Diaries?
Yeah. But like, it's not just that. It's like all of those.
Everywhere.
No, everywhere. It's everywhere.
And honestly, like Monique was saying, like you as the listener, like reflect on it. I'm listening now, like to you guys talking about it, and I'm reflecting, like, whenever I want to dress up, why do I straighten my hair? Why do I think that dressing up means like I should straighten my hair, you know? And I'm guilty of that. Now I'm like reflecting, like, why is it whenever I dress up or whenever I go somewhere fancy or, you know, professional or something, I'm more inclined to straighten my hair.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh my God, Esty, when you said that, I was like, oh my God, the You Belong With Me music video. That's the first thing that came to mind. And the thing is, it's everywhere. So like, that's literally so many examples. So, and it's all the same. It's all the same. Like I said, it falls very flat. And then it does give us that whole thing about negative self-confidence and poor body image and such.
You know what's, I don't know if you guys watched Encanto, I think it's called. It's more, there's more like, I think Latina, if I'm not mistaken, representation. Yeah. And like, I was just looking like, oh my God, they did such a good thing with the representation. But I'm looking at one of the sisters in the movie, I forget her name. She's considered the perfect child. She has long straight hair, flowers, only positivity, and like super skinny, the unrealistic body type. And I'm like, you know, maybe it still lingers in there, you know? Even if there's more representation, there's always something like, why is she the perfect one? I'm not saying that she shouldn't, but why is she just the perfect one, you know?
Why is she the only one? Why is it that that fits the criteria?
Exactly.
And so many times these animated films, they always, the bodies are always like disproportionate. Have you seen those videos that are like trying to make Disney princesses more realistic? And
it's still unrealistic.
Yeah.
It's even with the dolls as well. Like the dolls have humongous lips. They have long eyelashes, and it's
brats.
Brats.
The waist is this tiny.
It's not even what a little girl should be. Yeah, a little leg.
No, it literally looks like they're bobbleheads. I'm like, why is their head so big compared to their body?
The head is so big always, and the big hair.
Yeah, which I feel represented because I have a big head, but you know, in every other aspect. It doesn't make sense. Okay, it's fine. Like we've been saying before, that is achievable for some people, but it's when everyone is not represented in those things, and it makes you believe that you have to be this one thing, and you have to change everything about yourself to adhere to these beauty standards, you know?
Exactly. Like, we're not saying that there's something wrong with the ideal beauty standard or whatever. We're just saying that it shouldn't be the beauty standard, you know?
There shouldn't be a beauty standard.
Exactly.
And it also leads to like a lot of competition between like women and stuff. Like when you're online, you see someone with, you know, they're wearing a bathing suit and stuff, and you begin to look at yourself and say, how come I don't look like that? How come I don't have what she has?
That's so funny that you mentioned, like, every time I'm scrolling through TikTok and like there's someone, like there's a girl in a bikini or in tight revealing clothing, I guess you could say, everyone's like bashing at her almost, like, because like, no, you have BBL, you did this, you did that. But then when we go see like someone who doesn't fit apparently the ideal beauty or body type, I've noticed that they're like, oh my God, queen, like your smile is so contagious, your smile is so contagious. They just don't focus on like what, and like part of it is like, you know, it's subconsciously, you don't want to focus on it. And I'm like,
that's a good point. Have you seen that thing there where they're like, I love your confidence, and like as if you should be confident like that, and everyone's like, it's
very backhanded.
It's a very bad, it's not a compliment if you want to say that, it's a very bad one, as if there's nothing to be confident about there. I know you wouldn't say that if someone was fitting your beauty standards. I just know you wouldn't.
But we also have to take into context, when people say that to someone who fits the ideal standard, it's considered a compliment, right? Oh my God, you're beautiful and you're confident. There's mixed meanings behind it. Like, it depends who you're saying it to and what the context is, which obviously isn't right.
No, totally, 100%. And the way it affects ourselves, it's it's so hard to spot because, like you said, it's subconscious.
And now also in the media, like, it's so common that we don't really see the same level of equality in relation to opportunities between girls, boys, men, and women. So that's also something that is very common mm-hmm. shown in media.
Yeah, it goes back to the self-confidence thing, because it's like we don't feel like we're worthy or equipped to do certain things or to be certain things. That's why we're always talking about like women in STEM or like representation in field A, B, and C. It's because we never had that, and it becomes a thing of like, okay, well, I can't see anyone who looks like me who's doing that thing. That means I cannot do that thing, you know?
Yeah, and you know what? When there is an opportunity, but then they're like, hey, we want someone that fits this criteria. Hey, here's an opportunity for you. It's still done so poorly. It's even worse, arguably. People say, hey, I'd rather you just not do it than disrespect a certain group like that. Because I think another point to consider is that people that direct such media, they have not lived those experiences. So their view and their like their approach is very insensitive and very narrow and just not very well fit.
Yeah. There's a lot of stuff. I'm like on Book Talk. No, but there's a lot of discourse around like typically white authors writing people of color and comparing them to foods. And it's just so funny to me, but it's a real thing where like, if you don't have that experience, it's hard for you to kind of write from that place. And that leads to poor representation, right? Art has been and always will be an integral part of activism. So having examined some of the more damaging aspects of common media culture, we also wanted to take the time to celebrate some of the positive media that is breaking barriers and allowing us to take great strides in the realm of feminism, representation, all that great stuff. So we wanted to bring up a couple of our favorite examples. I know one of mine is from Little Women, which was a book, but also a movie. There was this really good monologue by Jo March.
I just feel like women, they have minds and they have souls as well as just hearts, and they've got ambition and they've got talent as well as just beauty. And I'm so sick of people saying that love is just all a woman is fit for. I'm so sick of it.
And that goes back to the whole fairy tale thing where it's like everything is focused on this love with the handsome prince and things like that. And I feel like this whole movie is really good at representing that, where you can be that and that's great for you, but that's not the only thing that you can be. And Jo is a character who kind of strays away from that a little bit, and she gets kind of, she gets like backlash for that. But I think this is like a great movie in general to kind of look at for some good representation.
It definitely fits to what we've been talking about like how we were just talking about beauty, like that's all the woman is for, just beauty, to be loved, I guess. But like there's a lot of movies don't say that these women have other passions or other wants and needs other than to be beautiful and to be in a loving relationship or whatever. And I'm like, but I will definitely be watching this and reading the book. But yeah.
Yeah, definitely, for sure. Like, you always see women kind of portrayed sometimes as if superficial, as if they don't really have a brain. They never really experience anything other than just being a pretty girl. And that's often seen with girls who are blonde, you know, you have this certain stereotype where they're not intelligent. They're just there. They're pretty. They get everything they want. So it's important to know that there's more to girls than just how they look like. Okay, so for me, the main thing that came to me was Cheetah Girls. That was my childhood, so you know I had to bring that in. Cinderella, I hope y'all all know that. But Raven Simone, That's So Raven.
I know the 10 soundtrack.
All key shows of my childhood, so. what's said in this song is the whole handsome prince coming to save Cinderella, and that leads into exactly our whole podcast, talking about how girls are, they're just waiting to be saved by somebody. So Cinderella by Cheetah Girls, thank you for this song used in this podcast. Thank you for that.
And then the last example we want to showcase is from Jane Eyre, which is like one of my favorite books to like ever exist in life. 10 out of 10, would recommend if you like old books. It's kind of a long monologue, but basically Jane is kind of explaining to this dude that she has emotions just like men, and she has things to do, and she has interests, and she feels like stagnated, and she feels like she can only be one thing or do one thing or look one way. And it doesn't make sense to condemn women for wanting to be more than what society says that they are.
I'm just gonna add that I think that's a really important like we've mentioned and hopefully emphasized in this podcast, is that we're more than just like emotions, I guess you could say, or like you said, Esty, that we have emotions obviously like men, but in terms of what I was saying emotions, I meant like love, to be rescued, to be like, oh my God, I'm in so much fear, I need someone to come save me. Like, that's, you don't need that.
Mara, that really touches on this whole thing that that women are emotional. And it's like damsel in distress, is it because they're emotional? But then this is also a very common way of gaslighting women on literally everything. It's not even restricted to one thing or the other. It just goes
hand. And a lot of shows are like, oh my God, you're so emotional, or you overthink too much, or you do this too much. And I'm like,
but then you have to think about like, why is it that we get emotional or whatever? And then why do you have to push it like that? Why do you have to push that narrative?
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
It clearly is helping you.
100%.
And mm-hmm. It also brings up different things about how men and women are perceived by other people. Like in the workplace, if a man says something kind of sternly, he is assertive, and that's a great thing. But if a woman says the exact same thing, that's aggressive. And like things like that, where you can see that gender difference in so many areas of your life.
Have 100%. You seen,
go ahead.
Have you seen that, those TikToks that are like changing my emails to how a man would write them? And like yeah. All the courtesy is gone, all the exclamation points, all the greetings are gone.
Do it now instead of, would you be able to do it at your earliest convenience, please? Do it now.
It's like good morning, David. Hope you had a nice weekend. Please give me the updated file as soon as possible. Thank you. And it's like a good sign off, but like she changed it to like morning David or just David. You had a weekend. Great. And it was so funny, but it's true. You don't even have to say the weekend part. You can just be like, send it to me right now.
Get to the point. Yeah.
Update. Send it now.
Updating my email style to match my male colleagues. Good.
Speaking of what Esty and you also touched on about how like a woman is perceived like or a man is perceived assertive when he does something a certain way, but a woman not so much, like for our viewers, please check out our like episode 2. We touch on this a lot. We talk about how women in the workplace, and I mentioned that same example where I had a professor saying like, oh, for a professor who's a woman, when she's not smiling, people are like, why aren't you smiling? But when a male professor is smiling or not smiling, there's no question revolving around it. And I'm like,
how dare you not show emotion? How dare you not put in the box I put you in?
Yeah.
I feel like it kind of leads to the question of like, how can we change this? Like, how can we change the notion that women show emotion just as men do?
We need to hold people accountable, but it never ends up going through because it sounds so difficult sometimes, but what we do is so limiting.
And I want to touch on like holding people accountable, and that includes ourselves too. Because I know sometimes I'm guilty of saying something that emphasizes the stereotype that we see in like media, which isn't good, of course. Like, I need to hold myself accountable and go like, why am I thinking that way? Like, that's not okay. And yeah. I think it really starts with us first, before we start holding other people accountable. Mm-hmm. And obviously we've been trying to hold media accountable, like the media, but with the widespread of media, that's so hard.
It's true.
Yeah.
And it's true though, whenever like you think of positive or negative thoughts, it's like reflected in your actions. So if you think negatively, you'll exhibit negative behavior. So it's definitely important to reflect on.
For sure.
Exactly. And
like we were kind of talking about in the beginning, we're so immersed in the media from like the moment we come out the womb, and like even more mm-hmm. so with the next generation as technology continues to advance. So we need to make sure that the things that we are showing our kids aren't like reiterating those same types of stereotypes, because it stays with you your entire life. Like Mara was saying, sometimes you need to check yourself. Like, why do I think like that? Where did I learn that from? Like, who told me that? And
it's
like
all you really about need socialization
to, mm-hmm. for sure, absolutely. Yeah. You really need to like examine where that comes from and how we can do better for the next generation.
All right, awesome. Yeah, so that was a great discussion. Honestly, like I mentioned at the start, it really helped myself to reflect on a bunch of things that I've seen in the media and how it affects me and the way I think and act. This discussion really emphasizes the fact that having just simple conversations with people around you can really shift your mindset. And that's why we're so happy that we have this opportunity to produce Speak as an outlet for this.
Thank you all for listening to Speak, and we hope that you are encouraged to have your own discussions with your friends just like us, or even family members. Visit www.championsofchangeutm.com and follow our social media pages to keep up to date with our upcoming initiatives and to learn how you can be the change that your community needs to see. Until next time, remember to use your voice.